And again, thank you, Joy Choir, for sharing with us as we here this morning in the ordinance of baptism and also with our deacon ordination. What we're going to do in just a little while this morning is have part of the ordination, which is called laying on of hands. And at that time, I will give our ordained deacons instructions on what to do. So please just be ready and follow my lead, and we'll get through this okay. Look with me in your Bibles to Acts chapter 6. Spend a few moments this morning looking at what a deacon is. And we're doing this as we ordain Sean and Nathan into the deacon ministry. Notice I use the word ministry, for it is a ministry. God has left us here on this earth to serve Him, to serve His kingdom. So you are entering a specific type of ministry in your Christian service at this time. The passage of Scripture you're looking at in Acts, the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 7, is the foundational passage of ministry of a deacon. Now, the word deacon is not mentioned in this passage, but I'm convinced that these are deacons. That's what they did. They served the role. They served the purpose. And as you look at this passage, you will see that the ministry of deacons began during a problem in the church. It kind of seems like deacons and problems have gone together throughout the ministry of the church. They're not there to cause the problems. They're there to help solve the problems. And by the way, deacons have caught a bad rap over the years. Sometimes it may have been deserved, sometimes not. Heard a lot of deacon jokes in my life. Not all of them are true. One that I remember is about why preachers' kids are so mean. Y'all ever heard this one? Do you know why preachers' kids are so mean? Because they've been playing with the deacon's kids. Hopefully that's not exactly what we're talking about, because God has called us all to service and to ministry. Look at the text, Acts chapter 6. Now at this time, while the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint arose on the part of the Hellenistic Jews against the native Hebrews, because their widows were being overlooked in the daily serving of food. So the 12 summoned the congregation of disciples and said, "It is not desirable for us to neglect the word of God in order to serve tables. Therefore, brethren, select from yourselves 7 men of good reputation, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we may put in charge of this task. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." The statement found approval with the whole congregation, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, and Nicanor, and Timon, and Parmenas, and Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch. And these they brought before the apostles, and after praying, they laid their hands on them. The word of God kept on spreading, and the number of disciples continued to increase greatly in Jerusalem, and a great many of the priests were becoming obedient to the faith. When you look at this particular passage and the problem that was taking place, what the church was needing was servants. People who were willing to serve and do the work of ministry that would allow the apostles the time to spend in prayer and meditation, the study of the word, the directing of the church. So the church, through the leadership of the Spirit, selected these 7 men to be workers, to be servants, to be ministers of the church. And their particular task was to take care of the widows and the orphans and the poor, it seems, of the church. Over time, these people became the leaders in the church. But when you look throughout the New Testament and you find the role of deacon, it is never a leader that is a boss or a dictator, but rather it is a leader that is a servant. So as you're entering the deacon ministry, and for you that are deacons, I would remind you that yours is a ministry of service to Christ and to His kingdom. In particular, a ministry of service to this church where God has called you, where God has placed you. If you trace the root word of deacon back, you find it is connected with the word servant. If you trace it back, you will find that it means getting down into the dust, one who is willing to bend down to the dirty floor to do what needs to be done, not afraid to get dirty doing the work of ministry. Christ has called you to serve Him. Now, in churches, the role of deacons have changed. In Baptist churches, deacons work as servant leaders with the pastor under the leadership of the Lord with the congregation to accomplish the ministry here. Some denominations use one head pope, head bishop, who directs everything. Others use a group of elders or a group of deacons to direct the ministry of the church. But we as Baptists are congregational. That means we as a body operate, serve, work together. And as deacons, you're called to serve Christ by serving this church. Never forget that God is calling you not to a business, but to a ministry. I grew up in Cotton Mill Town. Those of you who have been in this area for any length of time are familiar with the textile industry and mill work. I never worked in the weave shop because I did not want to, but I've done a lot of other things throughout cotton mills growing up. In Griffin, we had what was known as mill villages. Are you familiar with that term? This means yes. I know you're with me. If you're not, it is the mill owns the houses and the land and the property and the store, and you either rent or buy. Everything you do is connected to that mill. Back in Griffin, there was one church, as well as many other churches, that operated this way, that the bosses in the mill were the deacons in the church. You ever heard of that? In this particular church, the chairman of deacons made every decision, whether it was staff, budgets, nominating committee, he did it. And it flowed naturally from how that community operated. He was the big boss at work in the little community mill village. He was the big boss at church, almost like a business model had worked its way into the Christian life. God has not called us to that type of model of doing church. About 30 years ago, churches began to catch the idea that something was different in the ministry of deacons, that we were not called to be the bosses of the church, but spiritual leaders, but servant leaders who worked together with the church to accomplish the work of ministry. Understand clearly, God is not called you to be a boss of this church, but to be a servant leader of this church. Emphasis on servanthood. Deacons are called to a high standard. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 8 and following. By the way, if I'm calling out scriptures too quick and you don't have a chance to write them down, I do my best to put the outline I preach on the internet, so you can go to that, to our website, and find an outline for scripture passages, just in case you ever want to know what scripture did he use. 1 Timothy 3, verses 8 and following. We find qualifications for a deacon, very similar to the qualification of a pastor. And my understanding of how Baptist churches work, deacons should be able to step in and do the role of a pastor when there is no pastor. Deacons should be able to step in and do the ministry of the church with the church. And understand something, folks. The ministry of this church is not just something the staff does or the deacons do. It's us. All of us. God has called us all to work and to serve, to do the work of ministry, and there's plenty that we can be doing to serve His kingdom. Well, here's the qualities. Worthy of respect, not a drunkard, honest, sincere, faithful in their marriage relationship, a man of faith, someone who is tested, someone who is above reproach. What a high standard God has called you to as deacons. What a high standard God calls us to as pastor. But let me tell you something, folks. I'm just of the belief that this is a standard that all of us need in our Christian life. Why should we have people who think any less of themselves than to be the very best they can be for God's kingdom? Hold yourself to a high standard for His kingdom, for His kingdom's work. Now, as deacons, because you are servant leaders, there's something very specific that you are called to do. You're called to that high standard for a reason. People watch your life. They watch your life. They look at what you're doing. oh, he's a deacon in that church and he's doing that. Wow. Hopefully that's always positive and not negative. Man, isn't God using them? Isn't God moving through the members of that church to change his community, to grow his kingdom? You are called to a higher standard as deacon because you are a spiritual leader. Grow spiritually. Lead others to grow spiritually. You are a representative of this church. When you leave here, people are going to know in this community, especially your friends and neighbors, you're ordained as a deacon now, and they're going to be watching your life. Live up to what Christ has called you to. You are accountable to God. In 1 Timothy as well, chapter 4, Paul says this, kind of encouraging words to young Timothy. Take pains with these things, be absorbed in them, so that your progress will be evident to all. Pay close attention to yourself and to your teaching. Persevere in these things, for as you do, you will ensure salvation both for yourself and for those who hear you. Never forget, God has called you to be a servant of his church. Church, never forget that your obligation is to pray for these men and for all our deacons and me as your pastor, that God use us and speak to us as we seek to be servant leaders to help this church work together to accomplish all that God has for us here. By the way, I hope you've picked up the theme through my preaching since I've been here. Work together, all of us, to accomplish his purpose. That's what a church is. Us working together to do his will. Now let me talk a few moments about this idea of laying on of hands. It's something we do not do a lot in Baptist churches, but we reserve it for very special times. It is something that is very biblical. It is not a passing of any magical power to you. When this group of men who are called a presbytery, when you get a group of elders or deacons together, it's called a presbytery. When they come and they lay hands on you in just a few moments, they're not going to be imparting anything super spiritual to you. They're not, you know, giving you any unction of themselves. But rather, there is something symbolic that they're doing. They're representing this church. And by placing their hands on you, they are showing that this church has recognized a call of God upon your life. And in essence, it's very much like a biblical blessing upon you. It is church approval for what God is doing. It is a recognition of God's calling upon your life. And it is in honor or recognition or noting that you're being set apart for special ministry. That's why we say ordination. You're ordained. You're set apart for this particular ministry. Back years ago when I took Hebrew, one of the things that we did after many, many hours and classes, we went to the temple in downtown Atlanta to go to a service in Hebrew. And I tell you what, my southern drawl trying to speak Hebrew and trying to listen to it, it was a trip. It was something else. Their sanctuaries are really nice and ornate, and the pomp and circumstance will astound you. If you ever have an opportunity to see one of the services, you can go. They go on Saturday, by the way, so you can not miss church here at the same time. Along the top of the building, there were hands in this shape. Like this. Do y'all know what that means? Anybody? Come on, sci-fi people. What does that mean? Live long and prosper. So I am looking in this temple, looking at all the stuff and all these hands. And I thought, wow, they're into Star Trek. Really big. Wasn't Star Trek. Somebody explained to this poor ignorant fellow what it really meant. This represents, for us, it kind of looks like a W. You see the W there? But it represents the first letter in the Hebrew alphabet of the word shalom. Peace. So all across the top of their building was the symbol of peace. And they further explained that when the priest would bless the congregation, When he would do a benediction, he would do the benediction this way. When he would lay hands on someone to bless them, he would form his hands in the shape of the sheen, the W letter, and he would pronounce the blessing upon them. And I thought, how appropriate that is. For in just a few moments, as you kneel before the Lord in this congregation, the ordained men will come by, and they will pronounce a blessing or benediction of you, of peace. And it reminds me of the peace of Christ that will guard your life, that will keep you. When all else seems to be failing, His peace is there. So at this point in our sermon, I'm going to ask if you would please come and kneel here, and if our ordained men would come and get in line this way. We're going to start the laying on of hands ordination. Todd is going to start it in just a moment.